In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Much like the early disciples and those followers of Jesus, after he had died on the cross and was laid in the tomb, they grieved. They had lost the one that they thought was the Messiah, or even the Son of God. And so they began to retrace the steps that he had made from the Praetorium all the way to the hill of Calvary and finally to the grave. At each of the places, they would stop and pause and remember what had happened at that particular location. That stop from stations means to stand. And so they would stand there and remember what happened to Jesus. This helped them with their grief at a time of loss. And during this time when we are away from the church in a physical way, perhaps it can help to console our hearts. The first station, Jesus is condemned to death. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. The last food he ate was at the Last Supper. He went and suffered in the garden, sweating blood, and was beaten on the way to the palace. By the time he finally entered into dialogue with Pilate, he was sleep-deprived, he was hungry, tired and dehydrated, hurting, and having bled. This was the practice of most people who were getting ready to interrogate someone. Sleep deprivation and hunger, making them very scared so that they might give over the truth. And here Jesus gives over the truth to Pilate's answer, "What is truth?" And Pilate can hardly believe it. He can hardly believe that anyone would tell him the truth. And he could hardly believe this truth that he was being told. And so in an effort to save himself, Jesus is condemned to death. The second station, Jesus receives his cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. At this point, we journey with Jesus, dehydrated and in pain, hungry and sleep deprived, having sweat blood, having been deserted by all those who were his apostles the night he needed them most. One of them betrayed him, another denied him three times, and all the rest scattered. And so now he receives the wood of his destruction. It's placed upon his shoulders when he can barely enough stand. The wood bites into his raw shoulders. The thorns are pressed firmly against his head. And he begins his death march to Calvary. The third station, Jesus falls the first time. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Is it any wonder that the first station after he receives his cross is that he falls? The weight of the cross is heavy enough, and yet most prisoners who were crucified were not beaten and scourged as Jesus was before they are made to carry their cross. If someone in good health could barely carry the cross, how much more someone who has been tortured? And if Jesus were carrying that cross for himself, perhaps he would have remained face down in the gravel. But because he was carrying it for us, he pushes his knees further into the gravel that has sliced them. He grasps the cross and slowly stands up and begins to walk again. The fourth station, Jesus meets his mother. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Once someone becomes a parent, they are never not a parent again. For even in heaven, we have parents. And so Jesus now encounters his grieving mother. As if it wasn't enough that she grieved when she lost him in the temple. As if it wasn't enough when she grieved when she lost him to public ministry. When she heard the jeers of the people around him, even though she knew he would only do good for them. Only knowing how much he loved them. And now she sees him having been tortured for our sins and on his way to the cross. Can any mother imagine looking into the eyes of her child and seeing such agony? But here she is embracing her son as one day she will embrace the world as her own. The fifth station, Simon helps Jesus carry the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Now even the Roman soldiers are concerned that he might die before he gets to Calvary. They're not concerned for his health necessarily, as much as they are by the fact that they themselves would have to carry the cross and his corpse up the hill. So they call in a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, to help him carry the cross. Simon has no grudge against this man, and yet he has no reason to help him either. And yet, either out of fear or out of pity, he helps Jesus to bear this burden. The sixth station, Veronica wipes the face of Jesus. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Now beaten and bloody, having fallen probably several times, Veronica approaches Jesus to wipe his face. She can offer no water or food, any other comfort, but to wipe away the sweat and the blood from his face. Her very name, Veronikon, means the true image, for it is said that Jesus left that image on her veil as a sort of gift to her in response to her act of charity. Jesus now continues his way up to Calvary. The seventh station, Jesus falls the second time. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Now this could be the second time or the 22nd time that he's fallen. He has barely enough strength to stand and yet carries this burden upon his shoulders. The soldiers continue to urge him on, and yet Jesus can no longer bear the weight of the cross. So now it is no longer him, but it is the Spirit working in him, that God gives him what he needs to continue this march, which is necessary for the salvation of the world. The eighth station, Jesus meets the women of Jerusalem. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Jesus has encountered many along this journey, some probably not named in the stations particularly. And here, weakened and burdened, dehydrated, tired, under the weight of this great cross, he encounters these women of Jerusalem crying, and along with their children. He tells them not to weep for him. It echoes of what he said earlier in the death of Lazarus, in the death of Jairus' daughter, or even the widow of Nain's son. Why are you weeping? I shall rise from the dead. And this resurrection will not be like Lazarus, or the Jairus' daughter, or the son of the widow of Nain. They were brought back to their former way of life. Do not weep for me, for I will be the firstborn of the dead, a totally new existence, and my Father's will be fulfilled. The ninth station, Jesus falls the third time. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. Jesus falls the third and final time, and it's right on the cusp of the hill of Calvary. He made it the whole way, and under the final weight of the cross, he can take no more. He falls down to the dust, and from this point forward, we'll put forth no effort other than to speak some final words to those who have gathered around him. The tenth station, Jesus is stripped of his garments. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. He has now reached his destination. He has overcome odds, pain, sleep deprivation, hunger, and now the ultimate torture. He is stripped of his garments, stripped of his dignity for everyone to see, opening the sores that had caked against the fabric. He is now laid down on the ground in the dust, his bloody skin picking up every stone and piece of dirt. And they cast a dice for his clothing. The 11th station, Jesus is nailed to the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. The method of crucifixion was gruesome, but the death was not by hemorrhaging or even through shock, as much as it was suffocation. Jesus suffocated over 3 hours of intense agony, taking breaths only to speak the last 7 words that we would hear. He is nailed to the cross as a message for all to see. If you are to be a follower of me, you too must pick up your cross. The 12th station, Jesus dies on the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. He looks at his mother and says, "Woman, behold your son." He looks at John. "John, behold your mother." There are two thieves crucified next to him. And the one says to him, "Why not save us and yourself?" The other thief says, "Do you not fear God, even as you are dying?" And Jesus promises him, this day he will be with him in paradise. He cries out, "I thirst." And he's given some wine or some vinegar. And at this he says, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." It is accomplished. And with this he bowed his head and died. The 13th station, Jesus is taken down from the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. As if the grief was not bad enough to see her son tortured, seeing him carry a cross, seeing him die through crucifixion, now the Blessed Mother holds her child, much as she did when he was a baby. Mary must now journey alone with John, the beloved apostle, to whom she is entrusted, and her to whom he is entrusted. And they will place now Jesus in the grave. The 13th station, Jesus is taken down from the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. Can you imagine having seen your son tortured, led through the streets carrying his own instrument of destruction, and then crucified on Calvary, only now to have his lifeless body placed in your arms? She cradles him much as she did when he was a little baby, and now he is gone. She will go with John, having been entrusted to him, and she will grieve the loss of her only son. The 14th station, Jesus is laid in the tomb. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. As if it was not enough to say goodbye as he died on the cross, as they took his body, now they must say goodbye as they place the boulder over the cave. They will no longer see his face. They will no longer hear his words or see his miracles. At least that's what they think. As they exit the cold tomb, they know they have the intention to return only days later in order to perfume the body. At this point, they walk away, grieving as if they have lost everything. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.